Saga Egmont presents The Langstone Harbour Murders by Pauline Rowson, read by Colin Mace. Note to the listener. Please note, this book is set in the early 2000s, when technology was somewhat different. Chapter 1. Friday, 5:45 a.m.
Thought you might like this, Sergeant Cantelli said, placing a brown plastic beaker on Horton's desk. Horton stared at the frothy liquid that resembled dirty washing up water and said,
Are you trying to poison me?
It might help keep you awake.
Doesn't seem to be doing the trick with you. Horton thought Cantelli looked like something they'd exhumed from Milton's cemetery.
Sit down before you fall down. My bones ache. My head's thumping. And I think I've caught a cold.
Cantelli sneezed just to prove it.
That's about all we did catch, Horton replied with bitterness.
All they had to show for over 90 minutes of surveillance, crouched in a fishing boat at Portsmouth's town Camber in the pouring rain, was a bag full of stolen antiques and Mickey Johnson, who had conveniently lost his voice. Any joy finding out who Johnson's victims are? Horton asked, spinning round in his chair and plucking both his socks and trainers off the radiator where he had left them to dry.
Nothing. We won't know who he's turned over until they report it, or Mickey decides to confide in us. I could wring his scrawny neck.
Horton slipped on his trainers and straightened up with a groan. Cantelli wasn't the only one whose bones were protesting. What about the boat? It certainly wasn't Johnson's unless Social Security benefit had just got a hell of a lot better. If it hadn't been for that blessed drunk stumbling onto it by mistake, then Horton would have caught both of their antiques thieves and not just Johnson. He recalled with a stab of shame how he'd been poleaxed with cramp while chasing Johnson's young accomplice across the Cathedral Green. He'd given uniform a description, but it wasn't much to go on. It had been too dark, and the lad had been wearing a hoodie. Cantelli said,
There was nothing on it to give us an ID.
Sergeant Elkins says he'll try the town Camber offices when they're open.
What bugs me is that antiques aren't usually Mickey's thing. DVDs, televisions, computers, jewellery and money, yes, but paintings.
Mickey couldn't tell a valuable painting from a picture postcard, and yet he stole some by William Wiley on that first job.
Perhaps the runaway youth is the brains behind the operation. Cantelli ventured, yawning widely.
Somehow, Horton couldn't see it. Pulling his sailing jacket off the radiator and draping it over the coat stand next to his leather biker jacket, he said, What else has come in? Clearly, with an effort, Cantelli stirred himself to reply.
There's been a break-in at the X-Forces Club in Lamport, and another at the Sir Wilberforce Cutler School. The steward at the club went to accident and emergency, but it was just a surface head wound. Some cigarettes and booze were stolen.
And the school?
Building material.
I'll send someone round in the morning. It was morning, almost 6 o'clock. He was ready for his bed, and Cantelli looked as though he was about to fall asleep in the chair. He told Cantelli to get off home. He would do the same after putting the finishing touches to his report. But he had hardly got started when his phone rang. It was Sergeant Elkins of the Marine Unit.
The Langstone Harbour Master's just radioed us, Inspector. A fisherman has reported seeing something on the Mulberry and thinks we should take a look.
For a moment, Horton couldn't think what the Mulberry was. Then his brain clicked into gear. He recalled that it had started life in the Second World War when it had been built as part of a floating harbour for the D-Day landings. Whilst it was being towed out of Langstone Harbour, it had developed a fatal crack and was now listed on the charts as a concrete structure nestling on the edge of Sinus Sands. Horton frowned, puzzled. Elkins was quite capable of investigating this himself, so why call him?
Any idea what it is? He was thinking of bed and a long sleep. No, but Ray was very insistent that I call you.
Horton sat up at that. He'd known the harbour master for several years. Ray Thompson was a practical man, not given to flights of fancy or hysterics. So what had rattled him? I'll meet you at the landing stage, Portsmouth side, in 10 minutes. Horton consoled himself with the fact that Langstone was a stone's throw from his home, which was a boat in South Sea Marina, and if this turned out to be nothing, he would be in his bunk in less than an hour. The streets were quiet as he rode through them on the Harley. The rush hour hadn't begun, and the late October sun had yet to rise. Horton's mind went back to the antiques robberies. Perhaps he was missing something crucial. There had been 4 burglaries in as many weeks. All the burgled houses had alarm systems, which had been expertly disabled. They'd checked out the security companies that had supplied the alarms, and there didn't seem to be any common factor between them. They weren't even installed by the same company, and no security firm in its right mind would employ Johnson. So how had Johnson and his mate known that the owners would be away or out for the night? On the previous robberies, there had been no physical signs of breaking and entering, which meant that a key had been used. No key had been found on Johnson, so the youth must still have it. Damn his cramp, and damn Mickey Johnson. Horton turned onto the blustery seafront and headed east. A heavy drizzle was falling as he sped past his marina. He glanced at his boat, yearning for a hot shower, some breakfast, and his bunk, and thought enviously of Cantelli, who was probably already under a warm duvet. The car park was deserted as he swung into it at the end of the road, and, staring across the dark expanse of swirling sea, he picked out the black, humpbacked shape of the Mulberry. He could see the harbour master's rib the other side of it, and by the time Horton had locked his helmet on the Harley and ran down the pontoon, the police launch was coming alongside. He leapt on board, without Elkins having to moor up, and as PC Ripley pulled away, once again Horton's thoughts turned to Cantelli. The sergeant had had a lucky escape. He got seasick on a paddle boat. It had taken all Horton's persuasive skills to get him on that fishing boat in the camber. "What have you found, Ray?" Horton shouted as the police launch drew up in front of the Mulberry. "Not sure, Andy, and I thought it best to leave it to you." Horton heard the wariness in the harbour master's voice and knew by the uncharacteristic grimness of his expression that whatever it was on the Mulberry, Ray Tomsett didn't much care for it. Horton was filled with foreboding. It was more than the chill of the morning that caused him to shiver. After 18 years on the force, he could smell trouble from a mile away, and this was beginning to stink to high heaven. A cold creep of dread fingered its way up his spine, and with it came the adrenaline surge that pre-heralded the possibility of a high-level incident. All his fatigue sloughed off him. Now he was wide awake. At first glance, though, he could see nothing unusual. The seaweed-strewn lower slopes were covered with buoys, lobster pots, fishing nets, rusting anchor chains and a pile of crates. A couple of seagulls, which were perched on top of the Mulberry, turned northwest into the wind and glided away, squealing. With a quickening heartbeat, he donned a life jacket and climbed off the police launch onto the Mulberry. Sergeant Elkins followed, whilst Ripley stayed at the helm. It was then that Horton saw what must have caught the fisherman's eye and what Ray had spotted. Protruding from a bundle of dark ochre fishing nets was a pair of legs, clothed in black trousers. His heart thudded against his chest. This wasn't some poor unfortunate fisherman who'd suffered a heart attack, not unless he'd taken to wearing high-heeled black court shoes. "Torch," he commanded. Sunrise was still about an hour away, and the overcast weather was making it darker than usual. And yet, that fisherman had seen this. How? Had he motored so close to the Mulberry that he was able to discern the pair of legs without a torch or light from his boat? Horton doubted it. Or had he collected some of his fishing paraphernalia from the Mulberry, spotted this and scampered away, not wanting to get involved? Losing a day's fishing meant losing a day's wage. That was more like it. He steeled himself and switched on the powerful beam. The seagulls wheeled overhead, diving low over them, cawing loudly. Horton could hear the drone of the traffic from the dual carriageway to the north of the harbour. He clicked his fingers. "Gloves." Elkins handed him a pair, and, like Horton, stretched his fingers inside the tight latex. "Ready?" Elkins nodded, breathing heavily. Slowly and carefully, Horton lifted the fisherman's nets. 100 tiny crabs shot out.
Jesus!
Elkins exclaimed, jumping back and almost slipping over. Get a grip, Sergeant.
Sorry. Never did like the little buggers. Not even in a sandwich.
Horton's heart was beating rapidly. Give me a hand. Together they slowly peeled back the netting until the bright beam fell on a face. Elkins retched. Horton dashed his head away, took a deep breath, and slowly let it out, counting to 10. Then, steeling himself, his stomach clenched, he turned back to stare at the body. It was a woman. Her shoulder-length black hair was curled onto her forehead and what remained of her cheeks. She was wearing an emerald-green blouse, black trousers, and enough gold jewellery to sell from a suitcase in the market, he thought. Robbery couldn't have been the motive. Tiny crabs covered her face. They were crawling in her mouth and over her eyes, over the soft, rotting flesh. The right-hand side of her temple was a mess of dried blood, bone, and sea life. Thank God the nets had covered her face, Horton thought, or the seagulls would have pecked at her eyes. He felt sick and very angry that someone could have killed her and just dumped her here like rubbish. Who was she? How had she got here? Who could have killed her and why? He wanted to be in on this investigation. He wanted to find out what kind of sick bastard could do such a thing and to bring that person to justice. That was if Detective Superintendent Uckfield appointed him to his newly formed major crime team. There was no reason he shouldn't. After all, hadn't Uckfield promised him that just before going before the promotion board? It had been right after their last major murder case together. If I get the job, Andy, you'll be on my team. And yet, so far, there had been nothing from Uckfield, just an ominous silence. Horton climbed back onto the police launch and took out his mobile. Uckfield would be at his desk by now. Horton could see the first set of early commuters queuing for the hailing ferry. Usually, it was a short journey of a few minutes from one side of the harbour to the other, unless the ferry was picking up any fishermen. Then it would come close to the Mulberry, and Horton didn't want any sightseers. Leaning over the side of the police launch, he addressed the harbour master. Tell the ferryman to keep well away from here. Ray nodded, grim-faced, and sped off. Steve, it's Andy, Horton said, as Uckfield grunted a response. We've got a body on the Mulberry, in Langstone Harbour, female, Caucasian. I'm there now with Sergeant Elkins. I'm on my way. I'll notify Dr. Price. You call in Socco. Horton made a second call, and by the time he came off the phone, the harbour master had returned. The ferryman says it's just a straight crossing this morning. Wanted to know what was going on. I said I wasn't sure. Did you see anyone in the harbour last night? In that weather? You must be joking. What about the dredgers? Horton peered northwards through the grey morning. Beyond the small islands, which were nature reserves with restricted access, he could see the lights on the cranes at Bedhampton Wharf. His eyes flicked to the west. There was also Oldham's Wharf. Both supported a busy trade in sea-dredged aggregates. No, nothing went out. Horton asked Ray to collect the scene of crime team from the Portsmouth side of the harbour and then clambered back onto the Mulberry, where Elkins had recovered his equilibrium. She must have been killed and left here at high tide last night, Elkins said. High tide had been just after 3 a.m., Horton calculated, when he'd been questioning Mickey Johnson in a stuffy interview room. Elkins was right. If she had been put here on the previous high tide in mid-afternoon, there wouldn't have been much left of her face. And to place her in daylight would have been too risky. Someone might have witnessed it. He scanned the handful of fishing boats and a couple of motorboats left in the harbour for the winter. Could one of them have been used for the purpose? Or perhaps the killer had come here on a boat out of the nearest marina, which was where Horton's boat was moored. Access in and out of that was via an automatic tidal flap gate, which meant the marina was only accessible 3 hours either side of high water. That could put the time anywhere between midnight and 6 a.m. Perhaps the victim had gone willingly onto a boat with her murderer, or maybe the fisherman who had called up the harbour master had dumped her, though if he had, then why report it? And what about the residents either side of the harbour? Would they have seen anything? Horton doubted it. Too dark. He surveyed the area. To his right was the hailing shore, which gave on to the hailing billy coastal path spanning the length of the western side of the small island, which was joined to the mainland at its northern end by a bridge. The shore curved round to the right, leading to the grounds of the holiday centre known as Sina Warren. Had anyone from there seen anything suspicious? It was worth asking. And they'd have to check with those people living in the chalet-style buildings to the right of Sina Warren for any possible sightings. His eyes swiveled to the left and the Portsmouth shore. There were a few large houses facing onto the harbour, and behind them a tower block occupied by students of the University of Portsmouth. He doubted if any of them had noticed anything untoward, too busy getting pissed, partying, studying or shagging. He stared back at the body. It was a pretty strange place to dump it. Did the mulberry have any significance? Was this woman's death connected with something that had happened during the Second World War? Surely not. She wouldn't have been born then, not for some time afterwards. The throb of a powerful motorboat speeding towards them made him look up. It was another police launch, and on it he could see the squat figure of Uckfield wrapped in an oversized camel coat. Beside him was the lanky, long-haired figure of Dr. Price. "Any ID on her?" Uckfield bellowed as soon as he was within hailing distance. "I didn't want to disturb her. I thought the doctor could go through her pockets for us." Horton noted Price's horrified expression as he stared at the mulberry. "You're expecting me to climb onto that to examine her?" "She's hardly likely to come to you," Horton retorted, feeling the usual stab of antagonism that Price always managed to engender in him. While he didn't think Price totally incompetent, he nevertheless considered him mediocre and unprofessional, mainly because of his drink problem. That must surely cloud his judgment. Horton thought that Superintendent Reiner, head of operational command, could find a better police doctor than Price. But either Reiner was too lazy to do so, or he owed Price and didn't wish to rock the boat. How long before Price retired, he wondered, watching Price glare at the mulberry. 5 years? 3? Turning to Elkins, Horton said, "You and Ripley can get off duty. I'll go back with Superintendent Uckfield or Ray." With a grateful glance, Elkins climbed back on board his launch. Ripley started the engine and they pulled away, allowing Uckfield's police launch to get nearer to the mulberry. "You'll need a life jacket, Doctor, and a scene suit. If you hang on a moment, Phil's just on his way over," Horton shouted. He saw Phil Taylor and his team of three officers climb into the harbour master's rib, and within a couple of minutes they were beside them. Grumbling, Dr. Price shed his tatty barber and climbed into a scene suit and a life jacket. Horton helped him across to the mulberry. As Price staggered against him, Horton caught sight of the doctor's bloodshot eyes and grey skin. It looked as though Price had had a rough night, though judging by the smell of his breath, Horton thought he had been nursing a bottle of whiskey rather than a sick patient.
"Can't you get these bloody crabs off her?" Price growled.
Turning to Uckfield's launch, Horton reached for the boat hook and extended the pole so that he could reach the face without having to step any closer to the body and compromise the scene. He didn't need to do much to make the remaining crabs scuttle away. A gentle prod at a couple of them was enough. Horton handed back the boat hook and briefed Uckfield while Price carried out his examination of the body. "How come you got called out to this?" Uckfield asked, rubbing his fleshy nose and frowning. "I was just finishing off a surveillance operation," Horton answered, not wanting to go into too much detail, and admitting to Uckfield that he'd let one get away. Uckfield grunted. Horton thought he detected resentment. He eyed the big man curiously. Uckfield seemed uneasy and wouldn't look directly at him. What was bothering him? Perhaps he had some trouble at home. Horton could sympathize with that. He had a meeting with Catherine, his estranged wife, later. Their first meeting since she had thrown him out 6 months ago. He hoped they'd be able to come to an amicable agreement over Emma, as it had also been 6 months since he'd seen his young daughter, and that was far too long. Dr. Price was indicating that he wanted to return to the safety of the police launch. Horton helped him climb back on board and then joined him, nodding at Phil Taylor to instruct the videographer to go across to the Mulberry.
She was hit violently over the head.
Of course, that might not be what killed her, Price said, divesting himself of his life jacket and scene suit. Horton noticed he was looking rather green around the gills and guessed it was being on water that fazed him rather than examining bodies, as he'd never seen Price turn a hair before at even the grisliest of deaths. Price continued,
Rigor mortis and lividity are well established, so I would say she's been dead for about 6 to 9 hours, though it's a bugger to tell in these conditions. You'll need to get her on the mortuary slab to check that.
Horton said, That would make it between 10 p.m. and 1 a.m. Was there anything on her to give us an ID?
Only this.
Uckfield took the scrap of paper that Price held out and dropped it into a plastic evidence bag. He scrutinized it, frowned, and then handed it to Horton. It was a betting slip, and it was blank. Horton turned it over. On the back was written in a long, thin scrawl, Have you forgotten me? Had the victim written this note, or had someone given it to her? Either way, it didn't give him any clue as to the victim's identity. It did, however, give him a starting point. He said, The betting shop is Vinnaker's in Commercial Road.
Then you better get down there and start asking some questions, Uckfield said crisply.
I'm on the team then, Horton's heart lifted.
For now,
Uckfield replied coldly and looked away. Those words and the slight nuance in tone made Horton tense. But not for good. Is that what you're trying to say? We've got a job to do here, Inspector. Horton knew then why Uckfield wouldn't look him in the eye and why his manner was so hostile. You're appointing someone else as your DI, he said calmly, though his guts were churning, and he felt the bitter and sickening blow of disappointment. Uckfield didn't answer. I'll take a look at her, he said. Horton watched the bulky figure climb onto the Mulberry. He saw Uckfield stiffen as he gazed down on the corpse. Why had he had such a change of heart in the last 7 weeks? Uckfield had spent much of that time since his promotion to superintendent on courses and conferences. What had made him break his promise? Who had got at him? Horton was guessing that he had been overlooked because of his past. While he had been completely exonerated of charges of rape, when you trod in shit, it took a long time to get the stench from your shoes. And that smell around him obviously didn't suit Uckfield's ambitions. Well, sod him. Uckfield returned to the launch, Horton noted, not without some difficulty. Once Uckfield had been as fit as him. They had worked out together in the gym. Not so long ago, Uckfield would have vaulted over the side of the boat without any trouble. Perhaps that was what promotion and responsibility did for you. That, and make you shed your loyalties to your friends. He watched as Uckfield punched a digit on his mobile phone. The colour on his fleshy face was high, his grey eyes keen. Horton could feel the tension and excitement radiating from Uckfield at the prospect of heading his first major investigation since his appointment, and he felt both angry and betrayed. Crisply, Uckfield commanded the mobilisation of the major incident suite at the station and the mobile units to the Portsmouth side of the hailing ferry, with instructions to ask D.I. Lorraine Bliss from Havant Division to get her officers down to the hailing side. Dr. Price interjected.
If you don't mind, I'd like to get back on terra firma.
The inspector and I will come with you. A car will collect us from the Portsmouth pontoon. Uckfield left a parting shot for Taylor.
I want a report on this one quick. Understand?
Taylor nodded, but Horton knew that whatever was said, the thin and thorough Taylor would work at his own pace, steadily and methodically. They returned to the shore in silence. The doctor sat on one of the boulders in the car park, trying, Horton guessed, to settle his stomach and wishing for a brandy. Calculating he was out of earshot, Horton took his chance. I think you owe me an explanation, Steve, he said quietly and firmly. Uckfield kept his eyes on the road, scanning it for his car. We've got a murdered woman, and you have an investigation to undertake, he snapped. Finnaker's isn't open yet. There's time. We've known one another long enough to be honest. If you don't think I'm suitable for your team, then I'd like to know why. Uckfield spun round. He was a policeman. He had been schooled in the art of not showing his feelings. Horton saw nothing, not even a trace of their friendship. It was as if the past between them had been obliterated, which was what Horton guessed Uckfield had mentally done. "The appointment will be announced. Who's got the job, Steve?" insisted Horton, now with an edge of steel to his voice. "Tony Dennings." It felt like a slap in the face. "He's only just been promoted to inspector." Horton was hardly able to believe he'd been overlooked in preference for the man he had worked with on the undercover operation that had landed him with that rape charge. "He will join the major crime team a week today," Uckfield said curtly. "If this case is still running, you will hand it over to him. Now go home and take a shower. You smell worse than Billingsgate Fish Market. Get Sergeant Cantelli out of bed and find me a killer." Horton desperately wanted to ask, why Dennings? But he didn't bother. He wasn't likely to get the truth anyway. Besides, Horton knew the answer. Dennings hadn't blotted his copybook. Horton held Uckfield's eyes for a moment longer before climbing onto his Harley. So that was the way Steve wanted to play it. So be it. Horton was used to betrayal and disappointment in his life, but that didn't mean to say he was hardened to it. Once he would have said that he could rely on Uckfield, and yet, in the last 2 months, he'd been given cause to doubt his friendship, first on their last major case together, when Uckfield had believed him capable of murder, and now at his lack of openness and honesty. Horton called Cantelli.
"I've only just got my pajamas on," the sergeant protested.
"Good. I hate to think that I'd woken you." Sleep would have to wait for both of them, and so too would Mickey Johnson and the antiques thefts. He had a killer to find before Dennings could get so much as a toe inside the major incident room, and the trail started at Vinegar's betting shop in Commercial Road. Chapter 2. Friday, 9:10 a.m. Horton followed the manager's swaying hips through to a small office at the back of the betting shop. She waved him into the seat across a narrow desk, scratched and scarred with cup rings and cigarette burns, while Cantelli leaned against a battered grey filing cabinet to Horton's right. The room was so heavy with the sickly smell of her perfume that Horton wanted to push open the barred window behind her, though judging by the state of it, he doubted it would budge an inch. Elaine Tolley flashed him a smile as she settled her ample backside onto a creaking leather chair opposite him and crossed her legs. Horton didn't waste any time with preliminaries. He couldn't afford to. He was damned if he was going to hand this case over to Dennings. "Mrs. Tolley, can you confirm if this is one of your betting slips?" He gave her a photocopy. The original had been sent to the forensic lab. She took hold of it with bejeweled fingers. He saw that they were stained yellow with nicotine. Her vermilion nail varnish was chipped, and her nails bitten.
"Yes. Why do you want to know?"
"Do you recognize the handwriting on the back?" Holding it at a distance, she squinted at it. Then, sighing heavily, she picked up a pair of spectacles from her desk, her gold bracelets rattling and clinking as she settled them on her lined and heavily made-up face.
"Sign of old age," she said with a smile.
Horton didn't contradict her, and Cantelli looked too tired to pour on his usual charm. Horton watched for signs of recognition or surprise as she scrutinized the paper. He saw a slight widening of her eyes, and after a moment she pulled off her glasses and, with a puzzled frown, said,
"I think it's Eric Morville's writing."
"Can you tell us where we can find him?" Horton asked.
"At home, I guess, though if you wait a couple of hours, he'll be along here. What's happened? Why do you want to see him?"
She was beginning to look worried. "Do you know where he lives?" After a moment's hesitation, she said,
"Courton Court, number 14.
That backed onto the ex-forces club, where the break-in had been last night. Not that it had any significance to this case, Horton thought, but it reminded him that he hadn't detailed an officer to go round and interview the steward that had been injured. Elaine Tolley said,
"Has something happened to Mr. Morville?" She fiddled with a pen that had been lying on the desk. By her manner and her wary look, Horton got the impression that she knew this Eric Morville quite well, and probably intimately.
Not that we know of, Mrs. Tolly.
Does he have any family?
Her worry frown deepened.
He's never said.
Do you know why he should write that on one of your betting slips?
No.
Do you have a female customer or member of staff about 5'7", shoulder-length dark hair, mid-40s?
No.
She looked alarmed. Have you ever seen Mr. Morville with a woman who fits that description? Her eyes widened and her skin paled as she shifted nervously.
No. What is all this about? Eric Morville just places his bets, reads his newspaper and watches the telly.
Big winners, interjected Cantelli.
Hardly, she said caustically, swivelling her gaze to Cantelli. The boss wouldn't like that.
No, thought Horton, recalling his encounters with Charlie Vinnaker. He was a shrewd businessman in his early 60s, the owner of a chain of amusement arcades and casinos, as well as betting shops. Horton knew that he had been involved in some shady deals, but he'd never yet been able to prove it. Horton terminated the interview without giving her any hint of their line of inquiry, despite her efforts to extract it from him. There was nothing here, and he was keen to get away and elicit some answers from Eric Morville. He hoped she wouldn't telephone Morville to alert him of their impending arrival. Letting out the clutch, Cantelli slipped into the heavy traffic by the railway station.
What's happening about Mickey Johnson?
For a moment, Horton had forgotten all about him. I managed to get WPC Summerfield onto the case before Uckfield grabbed all the decent manpower.
Kate will enjoy that. She's a good officer. Maybe she can work her feminine charms on Johnson and get him to open his mouth.
Isn't it politically incorrect to say that?
Is it?
Cantelli sneezed.
I hope you're not going to get sick.
What?
And miss all the fun? Cantelli said with heavy irony.
Horton threw him a sharp look. Had Cantelli heard about Dennings's appointment? If he had, then surely he would have mentioned it. Soon it would be all over the station and the tongues would start wagging. Damn Uckfield. Okay, so Dennings was a good undercover cop with years of experience working in vice and drugs, but a detective on the major crime team? No. Horton, with his background in CID and experience undercover whilst on specialist investigations, would have been far more suitable. But then, he had to keep telling himself, it wasn't about suitability. He saw Uckfield's choice of Dennings as a criticism of his capabilities, both as a detective and a police officer, and he felt sure everyone else would see it as the same. But, he told himself, Cantelli was a friend and a loyal colleague, and if he couldn't face it out with Cantelli, then how was he going to handle the snide comments and sidelong looks that would swirl around the station like dirty dishwater when everyone knew? Abruptly, he gave Cantelli the news. The sergeant threw him a surprised glance before quickly putting his eyes back on the road.
I thought that was yours.
Yeah, so did I.
So why the change of heart?
Funnily enough, Uckfield didn't take me into his confidence, Horton replied sarcastically, but silently vowed that Uckfield would. He'd make him. Cantelli sniffed.
I suppose it was inevitable. Each to his own.
What do you mean? Horton knew Cantelli didn't much care for Uckfield, and that the feeling was mutual.
He cuts too many corners.
So does Uckfield.
That's what I mean. That's why Dennings has got the job, even though you're the best man for it.
Horton felt warmed and encouraged by Cantelli's loyalty, and perhaps he was right. Strangely enough, he found himself defending Dennings. We've all done it, Barney.
Yeah. But it's cutting corners and shaving them off to fit. Pity the poor bloody DCI who has to play piggy in the middle with those two. What will you do?
Stay in CID and worry the life out of you. Can't you go any faster?
Not unless this car can fly.
Horton stared out of the window at the traffic queue. Would there be others in the station who would see this appointment as Cantelli did? Perhaps he was being oversensitive in believing everyone would assume he'd been sidelined because he wasn't good enough. And who would be appointed the DCI on Uckfield's team? With his record, Horton guessed promotion was a long way off. Perhaps it would never happen, and he'd be stuck as a DI for the rest of his career. Would he mind? The answer was in the involuntary tensing of his body and the feeling of anger being swiftly followed by despondency. Once, he'd had such high hopes. For a moment, his depression seemed to match the dreary October day, but it didn't last long. As they turned into Courton Court, Horton's determination to show Uckfield that he'd picked the wrong man was rekindled. After all, the years spent fending for himself after his mother had left him when he was only 10 hadn't made him a quitter. Cantelli said,
"This place gets worse every time I see it."
Horton agreed. Courton Court exuded a damp aroma of desolation and neglect. It had been built in the 60s, and it looked as if it hadn't been touched since. The small communal front garden had given itself up to nature and rubbish long ago. He picked his way through the lager cans and cigarette packets littering the stairs and could hear the blare of the television long before he reached Eric Morville's front door on the third floor. It took a few stout knocks to get an answer. From inside came,
"If you're selling something, I don't want it. And if you're Jehovah's Witnesses, you can bugger off, I'm Catholic."
"Police, we'd like a word, Mr. Morville," Cantelli shouted.
After a moment, Horton could hear shuffling footsteps and the scraping and jingling of a door chain. The door was opened a crack, just wide enough for Cantelli to insert his warrant card.
"What do you want?"
came the surly reply. Did he already know? Thought Horton, pushing back the door and saying, "A word." Had Elaine Tolly told him? "I take it you are Mr. Eric Morville?" Horton eyed the thin man in his early 60s in a red and white striped pyjama jacket and a pair of grubby trousers and wondered if he could be the father or brother of the dead woman on the Mulberry. Could he be her killer? Morville didn't look as though he had the strength for it.
"Yeah, that's me. What's it to you?"
Morville's anger shifted to wariness. Behind his bloodshot, light brown eyes, Horton could see his mind racing as he tried to think what he might have done to bring the law down on him. Horton revised his opinion that Elaine Tolly might be involved with this man. If by some remote chance she was, then she badly needed a new pair of spectacles, he thought, taking in the gaunt face, unshaven chin, lank hair, and the yellowing, telltale skin of a heavy drinker.
"Can we come in?" Cantelli asked, easing past him.
"It looks like you already have,"
grunted Morville.
Horton stepped through the small hallway and into a room on his right. He'd seen many flats like this, shabby, dirty, and minimally equipped. The smell of fried food, tobacco, and stale sweat clawed at his throat, making him want to retch. There were two very worn and grubby armchairs in front of a large television screen showing a chat program. And between them was a stained coffee table on which sat a mug of coffee, a half-empty bottle of whiskey and a tobacco tin. On the wall to the right of the electric fire was a sideboard that looked as if it dated from the same time the flats had been built. It was devoid of photographs and ornaments, like the room it was in. Only a rickety lamp and a clock adorned it.
"How'd you feel?"
Morville asked harshly, crossing to one of the chairs. Lifting the television remote control, he punched down the volume, only to let the loud music from below thud up through the floor.
"I suppose you'll tell me what this is about in a moment."
Cantelli extracted the betting slip from his pocket.
"Is this your handwriting, sir?"
Horton watched Morville carefully as he scrutinized it. The slightest of starts betrayed that it was. Morville sat down.
"Who wants to know?"
"We do."
Horton forced himself to speak gently despite the fact that he'd taken an instant dislike to Morville. He told himself this man could just have lost his daughter or younger sister. He could, of course, be the killer. "Did you write that?" He repeated the question Cantelli had asked, but with more force. Morville picked up his tobacco tin and began to roll a cigarette with hands that were steady, yet he avoided direct eye contact. Horton had the impression of an arrogant man whom alcohol and laziness had made surly and bitter.
"The manager of the betting shop claims it's your writing," Cantelli persisted, taking out a handkerchief and blowing his nose.
"Does she?"
Morville replied airily, still not looking at them. He was beginning to get on Horton's nerves. Perhaps we should conduct this interview at the station. If you get dressed...
Okay. It's my writing. Satisfied?
Morville glanced up. Far from it, thought Horton. Why did you write that note?
None of your business.
Horton leaned closer to Morville, despite not really wanting to, as the man smelled.
It is our business, Mr. Morville, because we found that scrap of paper this morning on the body of a woman.
Morville's eyes widened.
You're having me on. This is a trick.
He glanced at each of them in turn, saw that they weren't kidding, and poured a generous measure of whiskey into an earthenware cup, which he proceeded to knock back in one go. You know who she was? Horton asked sharply.
No. Why should I?
The surliness was back, and along with it an increased nervousness that Morville was doing his best to disguise. How did it get onto her body, then?
How the bloody hell should I know? You're the detectives.
He took a drag of his cigarette, his eyes flicking up at Horton. In them, Horton thought he saw guilt, but then maybe he just wanted to see something that would give him a quick lead in this case. When did you write that note?
I can't remember. Tuesday? Wednesday?
Do you have any family?
No.
Have you ever been married?
No. And I've got no kids either, least ones that I know about.
Cantelli said, what about brothers or sisters?
I had a sister. She died 10 years ago. Massive stroke.
So the dead woman wasn't a relative. How long have you lived here? Horton asked.
Long enough.
Horton felt like shaking him. Mr. Morville, why won't you cooperate with us? Is there something you're hiding? Morville stubbed out his cigarette and poured himself another whiskey. Horton glanced at the clock. It was barely 10. The gesture was lost on Morville.
About 15 years, Morville said pointedly.
And before that?
I was in the Navy for 20 years.
That made Horton think of the sea, and in particular Langstone Harbour, where their victim had been found. But being in the Navy didn't mean that Morville could sail or even pilot a boat, though it probably meant he was aware of the rhythm of the tides. Time to increase the pressure. His voice harsher, Horton said, what does the note mean?
Probably the name of a horse or greyhound.
Have you forgotten me? It doesn't sound like a name to me.
Some of them greyhounds have funny names.
Then why hadn't Elaine Tolley recognised it? Which race was it in?
I can't remember. I didn't bet on it, just wrote it down. I like the sound of it.
I think you'd better get changed.
All right. So I wrote that on the betting slip and was going to give it to Elaine.
Morville shifted nervously.
She's the manager of the betting shop. We went out a couple of times and I was going to ask her for a date again. The note was a joke, a tease.
Again, why didn't Elaine Tolley tell them this? Morville must have read Horton's thoughts because he added,
she's married. I don't expect she wants anyone to know about us.
No. And who could blame her, thought Horton. No wonder she had looked worried. Morville continued,
I must have dropped it.
That didn't explain how it came to be in the victim's pocket. And if Morville was telling the truth, then why hadn't he jumped to the conclusion earlier that the dead woman could be Elaine Tolley? Horton hadn't described the victim to Morville. It was obvious Morville was making this up as he went along. Why? Where were you last night between 10 p.m. and 1 a.m?
At the X-Forces Club until just after 11. Then here.
Morville glared defiantly at Horton. He was too cocky. Morville could have killed their victim after 11 p.m, but why should he? And how would he have got her to the Mulberry? To do that required a boat, and judging by what he had seen so far, Horton thought that Morville wouldn't be able to afford a model boat, let alone a real one. Can anyone vouch for you returning here?
I doubt it.
No, thought Horton. Who would want to spend their time with this man? He asked,
Do you work?
I've been on invalidity benefit for 10 years, if it's any of your business. I had a heart attack at 52.
Horton looked pointedly at the whiskey and cigarettes. Morville snapped.
I've got bugger all else except this and a betting shop.
Horton left him to his vices, and with the threat that he might want to talk to him again. Morville might not own a boat, but he could know someone who did, which made him think of Mickey Johnson and the boat he'd taken the stolen antiques to last night. That had been borrowed, and they hadn't yet found out from whom. Horton felt far from satisfied about that note, which Cantelli seemed in agreement with.
He's not telling the truth, Cantelli announced, climbing into the car. Could he be the killer?
I shouldn't think he's got enough energy to get any further than the club or that betting shop. As for taking a boat into the Solent, I doubt he's seen the sea since he left the Navy. But there's definitely something not right about him. How did that betting slip end up in the victim's pocket? Why did Morville write that note? I certainly don't believe all that bollocks about it being the name of a greyhound or horse, but you better check it out and see if Morville's got any previous. Horton's mobile phone rang. He was expecting Uckfield and was surprised to hear Dr. Gay Clayton's West.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.